Welcome here to Town Hall. Hello, everyone, and welcome here to Town Hall. Here is episode number 115. I'm Solid Jake. This week, we've got Dunk Train and Battery from Astral Authority to give you guys all of your glorious Heroes of the Storm news. We're going to be talking about the brand new patch. We've got the Aureal kit confirmed. We've got some dank Arthas statues to talk about, esports discussion, and then even some drama to go with it. Glorious, glorious drama. But Dunk Train, how are you, my friend?
Oh, man. Doing okay now, but as some of you may know, I went to Comic-Con last weekend, which was interesting. It definitely was crazier than I expected. Had a lot of fun, saw some cool stuff, saw some weird stuff, and life goes on. But I brought home a gnarly flu that pretty much kept me in my bed for the past couple of days. So,
oh no,
getting over that.
You
probably
had that Comic-Con fever, man.
Yeah, dude, I had the Comic-Con.
No, that's like
the confluenza, you might call it. But okay, yeah, probably gonna get back to streaming this week.
Dunk, you've been to esports events for years now. Did you not bring like airborne or emergency?
Dude,
and
I never get sick at esports events. It's those filthy comic readers, dude. They bring so many more germs than esports. Esports people.
They're all sharing their comics, man. Not washing their hands.
Yeah, dude. Those comics, man. No, but yeah, that's pretty much what my weekend was.
Excellent. Excellent. Battery, welcome to the show for the very first time. Why don't you give everyone a bit of an introduction as to, well, I guess your nerdism and your background.
My nerdism, my background?
Yeah,
well,
man.
I've been a nerd forever. I don't remember a time when I wasn't one.
Good.
Pretty young. It's been being a nerd, it hasn't been easy. You know, it's been a rough life, all the social stigmas growing up, you know, but I powered through it. It's been real tough. Played a lot of games. First game I ever played was Doom when I was 3 years old.
Oh wow.
Probably not a very good idea.
No, that's a good start.
at the time that's like super weird, like, to let your kid do that, because like back then it was like there's a huge you know, debate about violence in video games. But nah, I've been playing games forever. Got into MOBAs about 6 years ago with League. Played it for a couple of years and saw Heroes, and I always like Blizzard games. I know they always do it right, so I jumped on over here. Just so happened to somehow turn out to be a pro. I'm not quite sure how I did it, but here I am.
Very cool. Well, we've got a lot to talk about tonight, but before we get into the Heroes discussion, you know, it's rare that I have to like ramble about my weekend activities, and I had a glorious weekend. Now, as many of you know, I'm getting married in a couple months, so I got a lot of the wedding planning done in the bag. My good friends, their names are Yasuno and Micah, Japanese married couple. They just moved back to Japan permanently to start a family. I got to say my farewells to them in New York City, so I had a New York City weekend where I caught many, many Pokemon. I got some nice Scythers. I like Scyther a lot. I'm really happy with that pickup. And then I saw this show called Stranger Things. And if you have Netflix and you have not watched Stranger Things, turn off the show right now and go watch that show, because it is ridiculously good. And as you guys know, I'm really into like that 80s dark synth revival type music, which it's got plentiful quantities of. So a lot of cool stuff for me this past weekend. And well, now we are here with Town Hall Heroes. So let's go straight into the patch notes with today's show. I actually think there's a lot to talk about here. And bam, that's not the right button.
Somewhere.
So we're going to open up with Chromie. Now, Chromie is a ranged assassin, one of the mages that has seen very little play. They've given her some small tweaks ever since she's been introduced to the game, but it looks like they're trying to diversify her a little bit. So Slowing Sands, they've reduced the mana cost to make it so you can just leave it up for an extended period of time. And the slow amount has actually received a pretty sizable buff. Now, yes, it's up to 60%, but it's after 3 seconds rather than 5 seconds. Do you guys think that's enough to make it viable?
Jake, I just want you to know before we talk about Chromie that you're a huge tease for doing patch notes first when there's all this drama going on.
That's 100% intentional. Right.
Get everyone itching for the drama talk.
We don't want to burn ourselves out on the passion talk. We want to
Take
it slow. We want to take it slow.
Take it slow. Right.
You know, these, I think a lot of people have had the thought that Chromie is like, she first comes out, not a lot of people really thought she was going to be good. And like, just because like, oh, this is a long range mage, it's hard to hit the skill shots, you have to use follow up CC. And if you do, even if you do, you have to anticipate that follow up CC. It's going to be really hard to get the guaranteed damage. So, and then some people had like a prophecy about her that, okay, well, if this damage is hard to hit, then they're going to keep buffing her and buffing her and buffing her until the damage is either too much to where you accidentally get hit by her, you lose 3/4 of your life, which is true for a lot of assassins. And I think they're still going down that road where she's just getting stronger and stronger, and she just becomes more and more RNG, like with low risk, insane reward. And like, you know, 1 times out of 10, you take out their carry is what it's going to turn into. And it's all about just, you know, getting better at that turn 1 out of 10, 1 out of 9, 1 out of 8, like see how close you can get it. And I think that at some point, this might be the patch. I think that mana cost reduction, that is huge. Like that is just, I mean, it might as well not even be there, because in a late game, like you've got more than 2 mana per second and she does not have mana problems.
Yeah, I think those are good buffs to her. I like that they're changing utility talents, though, and not the damage.
Definitely.
Like, I think that's good. That heroic was never picked, so now I think the slow ramp up is actually more important than the mana, because 60% from 50% is, like, a huge efficacy increase in that you're slow, and it's also way faster to ramp up.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. Maybe that heroic's actually pickable now.
I'm trying to think of, like, some of the synergies that could exist. It's not quite the snap call of a VP, but you can definitely have a lot more coverage and set up much more effectively with it, especially for various maps. You know, if you're thinking about Battlefield of Eternity, just going through the whole middle of the map, you can maybe deny the center point of there, or even on Infernal Shrines. You know, it's just, you have 3 seconds, boom. This whole part of the map is not a safe place for them to go. That's
too many choke points.
Yeah, exactly. So it could be really cool to see that all work out. What about the other changes, though? Mobius Loop, Chrono Sickness, Pocket of Time, Past, and Future Me, all seeing some changes.
Yeah, just trying to increase level 7 diversity a little bit. It looks like they're really trying to single out the Temporal Loop Instant Blow Up. They don't like the way that's working right now, it looks like. The nerf to damage on Past and Future Me, and the buffs to the alternatives to Dragon's Eye on level 7. So I think it's totally reasonable, just going to increase her talent diversity. She's going to have, you know, the Mobius Loop thing. Wasn't that where it was at when she initially released?
And then
it got, and it got nerfed, and now they're basically just undoing that nerf. So that's cool. I mean, I like that talent. I think it's healthier for the game for her to have the Mobius Loop build than the Dragon's Eye build be the main build, since, like, the one-shot potential is just really frustrating to play against, especially without a coordinated support who's going to, like, consistently save you from the reset, etc.
Yeah. I've always liked that talent. It's like, you've got one talent on the tier that's like, hey, like you think you're a good shot? Like, here's your reward. But like, hey, you don't care about, you know, killing people in one hit? Like, here's your talent. You got two different play styles that absolutely, like, benefit, you know, different team comps. And it's interesting they kind of moving this around, because, like, Mobius Loop, I don't really think, like, it really affects her kit too much. Like, people want to blow someone up, they're going to go with the other talent. You know, that the Mobius Loop doesn't really save you in that, what is it, 7 seconds when you go? Like, that talent? Like, 14, 7, if the fight lasts 7 seconds, then that talent's useless anyway, so.
Very true. Alrighty, well, moving down the list. Falstad. Mighty Gust has actually seen a pretty big nerf. The initial slow from 60 down to 40%, the movement speed decay has been reduced from 5 to 4 seconds. So, you know, Falstad has always been a top pick, even when Mighty Gust wasn't necessarily the norm. Once it became the norm, it became very dominant. It's seen several nerfs, primarily just actually in the actual cooldown of it, but now we're actually seeing a functionality nerf on the ability.
Yeah, good.
Good.
Why people pick him? I mean, you know, he's got a lot of utility, but it's the gust, you know, so much control.
I mean, just the displacement itself is insane, and I think there was just too much free crowd control tacked on afterwards.
Yeah.
And, like, it's hard to appreciate just how crippling that is, but it's super frustrating. So I totally like that nerf.
I mean, how many false set plays have we seen in the past where the gust is designed to just let the team catch up and then kill them? And, you know, now that's going to be far harder to do. And I like this change a lot. Gathering Storm also seeing a small nerf. Long term, though, that's pretty big.
Yeah, I think we'll have to see how much impact that does. I think no question Boomerang was doing too much damage before. So nerf seems fine. 1/4 less value from the talent. I don't know if that's going to make people switch to any of the other talents of that tier, because I don't think there's much on it that's very good from what I remember for Falstead's level 1, but still, at least you'll have a little less dominance of that, maybe.
Yeah, I think people are still going to pick it. It's just it's a nerf to something that is just still going to be standard. Like, people are still going to play it, and we want to make it so they're not having an unfair advantage as much as they would have before. So, like, they think it's too good, so they want to bring it down a little bit. People are still going to pick it. It's the only talent on the tier that really increases your damage consistently. So it makes sense to me.
Cool. Yeah, maybe we'll see some more false diversity. I guess the hard question here is there any chance whatsoever Hinterland Blast is ever picked up, even with the changes to Mighty Gust?
Maybe. I think 120 seconds is just too long, but I could see a cheese comp. Like, the enemy has no cleanse, and, like, you can take it and last pick Tyrael or something, and then LOL judgment them, but I don't know, man. It's just, like, 120 seconds is absurd. It's just... killing a target is not worth 120 second cooldown, basically, until the very end of the game is the problem. Like, the whole mid game, it's not worth it, especially considering you don't guarantee get a kill off of it, because there's, like, cleanse, there's spell shields, etc.
So if it was 90 seconds, would that be enough?
You're getting there. I mean, maybe.
Okay.
I don't know for sure.
Look at. I mean, just go back to the 120. Look at all the talents in the game that are 100 seconds or more, or, like, even close to that, like 90 and up. You got Maelstrom, you got Mosh, you got Sindragosa, you got Hinterland's Blast. It just doesn't fit the 120 second model of what an ult should do with such a long cooldown. You know, it's not generating this huge amount of nearly guaranteed damage. It's not producing any CC at all. And it's not turning fights. It's guaranteeing,
what if, like, it had
snap dive kills. Well, I was going to propose you do, like, a napalm strike situation where you drop the cooldown, like, to 10 seconds and just completely redo the kit, because, you know, right now Falstad's just this gust machine, and, like, he's got so much mobility and he's got so much CC. Like, let's give him a new playstyle. Like, let's not, like, people don't want to all in. Like, they don't want to gamble one kill and then lose the team fight, or even get the kill and lose the team fight. That's why people don't pick it, because it doesn't change anything. Like, you're still going to, all your CCs are going to be down, all your spells are going to be down killing that one person.
I've got a better idea.
Build the team.
Make Hinterland's Blast have global reach so that he can split soak wherever he wants, shoot that Hinterland's Blast across the map, 120 seconds justified. Stay in lane if he can. If he doesn't actually hit, he'll fly up and help in the fight, but just let him AFK push in bottom lane. That's the dream.
I can see that. I don't think anyone would contest that.
All right, Blizzard.
We'd still be in the same boat.
You have 2 weeks.
2 weeks. There you go.
I want this live before the second regional in North America. False had global presence with that Hinterland's Blast. Now that would...
It already has a global presence, but okay.
Nope, even more. Hinterland's Blast, not really going to be picked too much. Just going to be a nerf to the hero as a whole. But Falstead will probably still retain his prominence as a top pick, correct?
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, definitely.
It's too much damage.
He might see getting knocked off of that, like, first pick situation a little bit.
Okay.
I wouldn't be surprised to see him go a little later in draft, given the nerfs. But definitely still see play almost every game, I'm sure.
Yeah, you're pushing him with these kind of changes. They're not taking away his ability to like, play the game. They're just moving him away from that. Anyone can use him to, like, you're up against a comp that is hurt by gust. It's not so much that CCing them with the slow, it's much that you need to displace the entire enemy team because they're so cooldown based, or because they're so fragile that you want to do a flank or something. So this is kind of like what it pushes them towards. Whenever they nerf gust, that's what they're doing.
Yeah.
Chat's trying to claim that was their idea. I usually don't read chat during the show. That's my idea. Get out. Moving on. Greymane is a beautiful man. He's probably got the nicest beard in the game. Definitely nicer than Dunk Trains. We all know that much. But he's seen some nerfs. The Curse of the Worgen trait, the bonus damage has been decreased down to 40%. Some of the talents saw a buff in the last patch. Go for the Throat, the range has been reduced by roughly 20%. Not a flat 20, but like, you know, around there. Marked for the kill.
Like maybe 20. Like some games it's 19 and some games it's 21, you know?
It's like 25%, but they didn't want too much outrage, so they said roughly.
You know,
they don't even know the number. They're not even sure.
That's the dream, right?
Yeah.
Well, I think the reason is because range is like calculated from like center of your character, so like the distance looks odd. How like sometimes you'll get a range increase talent, and it's like, oh, this 15% increased range talent. Why does it feel like it's like a 30% range increase? Because the range value like starts from inside your character, whereas a player you identify as the space from the edge of your character to where you're hitting. So like that's why I think sometimes they have to use this wording, because maybe it's like an actual 20% nerf, but because of the way you perceive it, it's going to feel like more. And I think that's really good, because right now Greymane has way too much gap closers, and if you combine the Go for the Throat range nerf with the Worgen form damage decrease, I am really happy to see him get nerfs, and hopefully this makes it a little harder to get on that backline target for free.
I don't play too much Greymane, meaning I don't have the ranges memorized in my head, but I'm I think that Go for the Throat had a longer range than what's the E called?
Darklight?
Yeah, I think it one of my teammates, I just got out of a scrim, they said that Darklight is a bigger range than Go for the Throat now.
Ooh, wow. That's a huge change.
So like they're basically just removed the utility from Go for the Throat, like with this decision.
Yeah, a little bit.
It's like you have to already be on somebody. This isn't something you just get to use whenever you want and be in any part of the team fight that you want. Like you have to be killing someone and then finish them. Like,
so it's no longer a second engage, essentially.
That's what I heard. Don't take my word for it, but that's what my teammate said, and it was talking trees, so I mean, you know, he's I don't know. I'm not sure. I haven't seen it yet.
Basically, you're still going to see a lot of the EQR combo, but you're not going to be able to see the like E onto a melee target and then Go for the Throat way into the back line to kill like an escaping target. That's not going to be an option anymore.
What do you think about the 40-second cooldown on the other ult now?
I think it's still just bad. It's just a mark, right?
Yeah.
It's like it's a skill shot mark on a huge cooldown. Like it's worse than Tyrande trait, and it's a heroic. It's just, it needs a total rethink, honestly.
I think it's one of those spells that it's just people aren't giving it enough time. I think everybody, like, they, you know, they unlock Greymane, they go into a quick match, they see the two spells, and they're like, I don't care about this, like, one damage, 80-second cooldown, one hit. Like, what's up with that? I like this 40-second increased damage I can keep it going forever. That's awesome. That's really cool. They miss one shot and they're done, and that's it. And they don't want to mess with it anymore. And I think that Mark for the Kill is like, you know, every time it gets a little bit stronger. And I think that if they, I think any more to it, and it's gonna surpass Go for the Throat, in my opinion.
Interesting.
So this is the radius difference. This is the Dark Flight. And this is the Go for the Throat. So it's not huge.
Oh, it's about the same. It's about the same now.
Okay, it's a little smaller. Okay. But that's a big difference compared to B. It used to be bigger than the E, so that is a big difference.
20%, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
Roughly.
I'm not sure.
Kappa.
Okay, that's interesting. I think in the competitive scene, you saw a lot of Dark Flight into Go for the Throat already in melee range, so I'm not sure how much of a nerf it'll be, but it'll definitely decrease his mobility a little bit, which is fine. He's such a, like, knife's edge balanced hero, I feel like.
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, it's tough. He's the first hero they've put in the game that has multiple forms, too, so.
Mm-hmm. And he has no CC. He's all damage, so, like, if you nerf his damage even a little bit too much, then he stops being able to kill targets and he's never worth picking. If he's too good, then he's kind of like he was last patch, where he just always killed every target in melee form. So he's going to be hard to find the right balance.
Yeah, they seem like smart changes, though.
You know, when a hero gets, you know, in my opinion, infinite damage, like he has. I mean, you play like a like an Infernal Shrine game, he's gonna have that WO forever, and then he's got this Worgen. He's like, his ranged autos are fine. Like, they're totally in line with ranged auto attackers. He outpaces Rainer, like, with that W up. Like, and then if things get a little bit, you know, more quiet, or they, like, some CC goes out, he can go in with the E, and it's like the heroes is just like what Dunk's saying, it's so hard to balance this hero because you he's either just too much infinite damage with no cooldowns and no mana costs, or, you know, who cares if Greymane's attacking somebody for 5 seconds straight? Like, he it's a sustain, like, slow damage. So, you know, there's definitely, like, a tipping point there when it comes to Greymane.
Yeah, definitely.
Alrighty, moving down the list of Rooney and Cheese. Ghoul Dan, the newest addition to the game, starting to see a bit of love. Now, I'm going to use Dunk Train's explanation that this is kind of like the bruiser of the mages, where he's a little bit more tanky and a little bit less of a blow-up style hero, but he's going to get a bit of love in this patch. So going through things, his base health has gone up a bit, as well as his health regen, so he's already tanky, going to be even more so moving forward. Fel Flame, a nice big buff on the damage for his Q. Let's talk about that. Is
huge
that enough?
Buff.
Yeah?
Oh man, that spell does so much damage as it is. Like, it is such a great poke tool. I mean, what it does more damage than Jaina's Ice Lance, and it has, like, more range without, like, the Frost Lance talent at level 1. It's AoE. Like, it's almost impossible to miss. It's such a powerful spell. And you can spam it forever if you're healthy enough. So, like, that spell getting a buff, that's Gul'dan at its core. I kind of think it's a mistake. I'm sure, you know, give it a month or two and stuff's going to come back. It's going to get pulled back.
You think so? You think this is going to... I don't think so, man. I think he was really far from being good.
I might have had just a few bad scrim experiences with probably better teams, but it's just, like, he's just, to me, such a monster in the right situations. Like, and his W's already just so crazy. Like, to make his Q that much better is I think it might be too much. As far as those talents go, I've never seen anybody pick those talents, so...
Yeah, I think that's fine. Like, yeah, totally buffing fine. The underused talents is totally okay. The mana one actually seems pretty powerful now. If you look at the numbers, like, it definitely gives you a ton of extra spell casts once you complete the quest. It's just a question of whether it's worth taking it, considering you pretty much, in my opinion, need the returning corruption to get good damage, especially with the 16 talent. The Hellstone nerf is kind of weird. Like, he got a 3% max HP buff, and then Hellstone got nerfed by like 15%. It's like, what?
Only 5%.
Yeah, but it's like, it's 15% of the effective value of the talent, if that makes sense. 1/6. From 30 to 25. Yeah. So
I'm
like,
a commentator. I don't even try with math, man.
Using Hellstone is going to get him less health
gross.
Than before. Yeah. Using Hellstone is going to get him less health than before. Like, so taking the Hellstone talent, maybe it was just too good, so they just wanted to nerf it. But then in the developer comments, they're like, they nerfed it to keep it consistent with the current version, but that doesn't even make sense. So anyway, that was just my little gripe.
It just looks like a response to the health increase, but
yeah,
it's like it's an overshot. I mean, what's the percent increase on that first one? That's like
10. It's 3%. He gets 3% more max HP. Yeah, it's tiny. Yeah.
So I don't know. These are really small numbers. I just don't see them being that big of a deal either.
Yeah.
Like I said before, I don't even see people take these talents.
So, what do people take at 13?
More heal if you hit a hero.
Okay. Yeah, I like that talent a lot. That makes sense.
And I'm not talking about hero league. I'm not talking about quick match. I'm talking about
I like the war heal on hero. I think the Hellstone thing is kind of cute for unorganized play to bait people. But I think for competitive, the more heal is just going to get more value over time, probably.
I think a lot of the times, I'm a tank player, and he seems to hit me a lot. So, like, most of the time, like, I'm getting drained by a Gul'dan, I want to cancel him. But,
yeah.
You know, like, taking the increased heal on the drain just makes so much sense to me as someone who has to play against him.
Yeah.
Like, when I see the Hellstone change, I'm like, whatever. It's like, they want to nerf it, they want to buff. I don't think it changes anything.
All right.
What were you going to say about Felflam? I jumped over to the talents.
I was just going to say that I don't think the damage increase is going to be, like, so huge that they need to nerf him again or something. Like, he was really far from being viable, in my opinion, so I think the buff to Fel Flame isn't that much. Like, Haunt is so much of his power that the damage to Pelflame is good, and it's definitely going to be healthy for him. I think he'll actually be like pickable now in Hero League, for example, yeah. But I don't think he's going to be like broken. We're not going to see first pick Gul'dans, in my opinion.
Oh, definitely, definitely not that.
Yeah.
Well, maybe we'll see him played at all, which would be nice, in my opinion, because
yeah,
the more hero diversity, the better.
He's you're going to see him at Burbank. It's going to happen.
Oh, maybe some of those dank astral strats coming out.
Please ban it against us. I'd like for you to do that.
Okay. Moving down the line to Kael'thas, living bomb damage over time has been reduced from 50 to 40. I mean, it's a good nerf to KT. He's already really strong, but I don't know how much of a change this is. This is, again, leaning towards his single target damage, really. That's the ticking on that target, right? It doesn't actually affect the explosion damage.
Correct.
Yeah, it's like I don't have the numbers off the top of my head, but I think this is like, 50 to 40 is 20%, but I think this is like a 7% change.
Yeah, like because of the explosion
really,
damage, yeah.
Really small. So they think he does too much damage. They took it off in a spot that isn't making or breaking the game. Makes sense to me. It's really standard. You know, that's where all of KT's damage comes from. If you think he does too much damage, take it off there.
Yeah, it's fine. I wonder if this will influence anything. I don't know. He wasn't really getting like first pick that much even anymore. I feel like I don't know if he's.
Well, in some cases, super. Like if you could go KT ETC, that's when you're going to see him picked in the first rotation.
Yeah,
but that's
definitely.
About it.
Yeah, you're still going to see that combo. So I mean, I think he's still going to get picked. Just going to maybe.
I mean, it's a good.
His,
you know, I think KT's just become kind of. He's just they're pushing him more and more into niche, and that niche is stun. That's all.
Yeah.
He's just a stun machine.
That's fine.
I agree.
Like.
As the hero roster
expands,
yeah, but that's, yeah. I mean, is that a problem? How many ranged assassins have stuns? Like, that should be.
I like mages too much, so I don't like it when one of them starts going out of play, but I understand. I get what you're saying. I can't refute it.
I like him having that place in the meta, though, because, you know, Cloud9 was a team that was kind of known for the stun meta, so maybe there will be that kind of style draft popping out where KT is a crucial part of that, and that's where it becomes compelling. He shouldn't be. I don't like the idea of a hero always having that 100%. Like they're good in every scenario. I like it to be a little bit more niche myself. But
yeah, it makes sense.
Okay. All right, Kerrigan, who saw a massive rise in the most recent patch, especially here in North America, seeing some tweaks. So her health is going down. This is back exactly where it was, right?
Yeah.
So they
I think so.
They reverted her health. They reverted her regeneration. I don't know why this isn't orange. Maybe this is wrong. Because nothing. I've never seen something in orange.
Orange is a. They released the patch notes. They made a change.
Oh, it's an edit.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So like, you ever see those like where they did the PTR patch notes? The real patch notes come out and like you're like, wait, I thought that was there. Like, where's this? Where are the PTR notes? Like, what's the differences? So now they're doing this yellow thing now.
Sharpened blades, losing some damage. Yeah, I mean, is this just going to kind of put her back to where she was?
It's not fully reverting all the nerfs, right?
Right.
All the buffs?
Well,
still has the autos. E and W still do more damage.
Okay. Yeah.
It's just talents.
It's interesting. So the psionic pulse damage getting pulled back is really important. That talent was huge.
It's huge.
I wonder if it'll still get picked. Because the damage was insane and now the damage seems more manageable but still good. So I like that nerf. The bladed momentum nerf, totally fine. I don't know, I think she'll still get played, but I don't think she's going to be super duper high priority anymore. It's going to go back. It's not going to be as much as before where it's like only Infernal Shrines, but I think it will be like a late pick again, as opposed to like probably before second ban phase. Now it'll be like after second ban phase if the comps look good for it, if I had to guess.
Yeah, if any hero is being contested first pick on every single map,
I think
it's the duty of Blizzard to pull him back. Like,
of course,
it's just too much utility, too much CC, too much damage, and like you want to nerf the CC. Like look at how that's been in the past. Like look at Tyrande now. Like look at some of the other like stun people. Like you know they kind of fall out. You nerf the damage CC. Like she's where she needs to be. Like when it comes to how she engages, the fact she can kill people by herself, turn team fights by herself, is what makes like her so powerful. The health change, that only really doesn't that really only change Ravage, because she's still getting the same amount of shields. Like
Yeah, like, it's a solid nerf, but it's not like backbreaking.
Yeah, I mean, like, you don't pop Kerrigan when she goes in, like, regardless. Like, it still takes a little bit of team fights to take her, or it still takes a couple seconds to take her down. So this might just be, it might, like, you know, your healer is going to be like, okay, this person's at 50%, they're 40, they're 30, okay, time for a heal. It's just going to come faster, you know, like, so it's 20, it's 200 off the top, not 200 off the bottom, I'd say.
All right, moving down in away from the assassins to Brightwing, the poor fairy dragon that Blizzard just doesn't know what they want to do with. It seems she they expanded her build diversity recently by trying to take away the full on face shield style, and which basically spawned a full on new style where, if I'm correct in this, you go arcane flare build essentially to get as much resets as possible, just keep those mystified pulses coming out as frequently as humanly possible, and. Well, they've come in here with some changes to her. So Soothing Mist, the heal amount has been decreased from 120 to 115. So they've nerfed her trait at base. On top of that, the range increased on Soothing Mist. Range has been reduced from 33 to 20 for the Unfurling Spray at level 1. Mystified, again, cooldown reduction has gone down to 0.5 from 0.75. And then Shield Dust, the ability damage reduction has gone down as well. Some of the things that did change in the last patch that have stayed are the additional pulses coming out when you pick up Emerald Wind. So she does have that. So again, Emerald Wind might have a little bit more viability than in the past. Blink Heal did get nerfed in the last patch. Dunk, where do you think Brightwing kind of sits with this new patch?
I think these changes don't really do anything for competitive play. Like, look, Shield Dust was absurd. It probably needed a nerf, but Brightwing was never good enough to justify a nerf, and I still don't know if she's good enough now. She's just going to be in the same composition she was before, where she's like maybe a potential second healer. I don't like the Unfurling Spray nerf. It seems really random. The Mystified nerf is a pretty big deal, I would say, more than the nerf on Soothing Mist. So overall, just reduced average returns from her because of the base nerf on the trait and the Shield Dust nerf. So probably low priority, like you'll see her maybe once or twice at Burbank or something. I don't think the bonus split importance played out quite as heavily as we thought it would. In my experience, she's fine, but the whole like everyone running around as if the sky is falling because of the minion damage buff and then like, oh, you have to pick globals to defend against it, that didn't really happen that much, I don't think. And so now Brightwing didn't gain as much as we thought, and I think these nerfs, she's just kind of sitting in the same place she's always been, or at least recently, in the like weird composition second healer situation.
Okay, any thoughts on her, Battery?
I you know, like, I definitely agree with everything that Dunk says, and I think I really honestly think these changes for Hero League, like, this is a these are not competitive changes. I mean, Shield Dust going from 50 to 40, like, people weren't being bursted, like, and like not being killed, like, because of Shield Dust. Like, Shield Dust completely stops a kill. Like, this is just a slow, small, no change in playstyle. These are all everything about these changes is completely unintentional. You don't go where people are, like, you don't choose who gets healed. Range makes it easier to forget that you're healing somebody. Mystified, just more of the same. Like, you're going to cast spells. It doesn't matter if it's 0.75. It doesn't matter if it's 0.5. And then Shield Dust the same way. Like, it's just more the unintentional healing. Like, unintentional healing is very easy to heal with. I mean, you know. So if it's too good, you know, they have to tone it back. There has to be, you know, something there. So I think it's a competitive change at all.
I think you're totally right. If you look at the win rates, I mean, Brightwing has always had a pretty good win rate in Hero League, but like even right now, she's like second in overall win percent to Kerrigan. Exactly. So it's probably just a response to that, basically. Is like, okay, look, Brightwing's win rate is too high. Let's nerf something. And it looks like they maybe tried to hit stuff that, like you said, wasn't that relevant to competitive. Although the Shield Dust change goes against that kind of, but maybe they just felt that Talon was too good.
It will. I mean, you're right. It will.
But yeah, you're totally right. It's just a Hero League. Like, she's too good, so nerf her.
All right, cool. Well, Brightwing, still kind of a niche. We'll see where she lands in the pro scene. especially in Burbank. Medivh, minor tweaks. It's easier to click the portal, and now the portal has a cooldown of 0.25 rather than 0.5 after using it. So they're just making portals a little bit more responsive, I think, as a whole. There's still no giant arrow that says click me on it, which I think is probably what it needs, especially for quick match in Hero League, because I find I cast a portal to save someone and they're just like, nah, man, I'm not about that life. I'd rather die. It's like, all right, man, be that way.
Yeah, I think this is actually a really big buff for competitive, where people are going to use portal dancing to huge effect, like to drop aggro and stuff like that. So it's totally a buff to competitive, where he didn't need a buff. And then, well, maybe he did, I don't know, but we've seen him be really good in competitive, and it doesn't really change his Hero League. So I think he's going to be really good in competitive. I expect to see a ton of him at Burbank.
Oh, absolutely. He's, you know, this is like any high, incredibly high skill cap here, you know, you don't see a lot of him at first, and then he just starts getting buffed just slowly but surely. But what's actually happening is the best players are, they're just getting better instincts over longer periods of time. Like Medivh, like, just look at this kid, just look what he does. Like, it's too good. Like, the portals, the infinite damage stop, it's too good. People are just getting better and better and better at him. So like, I like the change, because it's not a numbers change.
Yeah, it's not a power increase.
Yeah,
but
portals didn't have a cooldown before, and then they got a half second. Now it's a quarter.
Yeah.
But they didn't specify that they were changing it to a half second.
Mm-hmm.
Now they are. So I think that kind of ends a Medivh's discussion by them saying that, like, by them stating it like it is right here. As far as portals, easy to click. I click them way too much. Like, I'm trying to kill somebody, and someone puts a portal right on top of me, and I'm on the other side of the wall. I'm like, oh my gosh, what just happened? Like, so, like, I don't want it to be easier to click. I want it to be harder to click. I think it's ridiculous. Too easy.
All right, I need a game setting that determines the radius of where I can click on the portal.
Let me control it. Yeah, let me control it.
No, I have seen the situation where you accidentally click a portal and it is frustrating, but, I mean, there were cases where, like, you're like, why didn't I go in the portal, etc. So the more time they spend polishing that, the better I think it'll get, regardless of whether the notes say increase or decrease or whatever. It's just polished, so any usability stuff like that is good.
Definitely.
All right, going down the line, one of the most deserved nerfs in a long time in Heroes of the Storm.
Yeah.
Gargantuan. They finally nerfed his basic attack damage. I mean, Nazebo in general has just been an absolute menace. First pick Hero League for months and months and months now.
Okay, in all seriousness, this patch note actually really upsets me. Because if you scroll down, Jake, if you scroll down to the bug fixes, you'll see Nazebo. The Toads of Huge's talent no longer causes Plague of Toads to deal more damage than intended. And, like, okay, I totally understand this is a bug, not technically a balance change, if you want to be really specific about it, but it's really frustrating that you could be reading these patch notes and see the Nazebo changes and be like, oh, Nazebo didn't get nerfed that hard, when in actuality, that bug change is an enormous nerf to Nazebo. Like, if you looked at the math on his Toads of Hugeness talent pick, even on when you first cast them, like, the way they were working is they were getting, like, 60 or 70% bonus damage for no reason right when they started. And, like, taking that away and only mentioning it in the bug section and not actually explaining how the power level changed is, like, huge. That's going to, I think, destroy Nazebo. I expect after this patch his win rate to drop, like, 10% in Hero League, honestly. He just lost an absurd amount of damage.
Wow.
He's a late game hero. That's a late game change, and it's huge. It's enormous. So definitely agree with that.
I haven't got to do my pre-oh in a cast in months and months and months now, and now I can't even do it in Hero League. Thanks, Blizzard.
Maybe this will make room for buffs to Nazebo, though?
Exactly. Transparency. Maybe.
Yeah. Like, if they, by fixing the bug, they open up the 13 talents, maybe, so you can actually pick other ones and hopefully buff him in ways where either, he is getting reworked, huh? He's one of those heroes that they've said is on the on the list of reworks for competitive, so that's fine. But yeah, the bug fix not being mentioned or even explained how much of a nerf it was is just kind of irking me about that.
Definitely.
That is true. Okay, well, down to Zool. Raised skeleton damage has been reduced. Good stuff. Yeah, just giving him a little bit less split push. With the change to all the minions being stronger, I think this is probably a good change. I mean, Zool was already really, really powerful when it came to just, you know, pressure in the lane. And raised skeletons do a lot of damage. They really do.
Yeah. And it's a lot of free damage. Like, you don't really see it, so it's hard to appreciate it. But they, like, the jailer skeletons or, like, you know, just a couple in the middle of a teamfight or something after clearing a wave, like, they actually hurt a lot. So I think it's a fine nerf, just a tiny, tiny reduction to the invisible power. And in general, I like nerfs to power that you don't really feel as much as, like, if you took a comparable amount of damage off of, like, his bone scythe or something, it would make the character feel a lot worse. Whereas taking the damage off the skeletons, yeah, he actually sees a power level nerf, but you don't feel it as directly. Yeah. So definitely, definitely good call there.
More changes for Nazebo. Shade, basically the Shade version of Bone Armor's cooldown has been increased up to 50 seconds. Shade already has the longest cooldown, correct? Isn't it 30 for the other ones? And no, it's 40 for Shade, and now it's 50. So yeah. I think this has, like, a, especially in competitive, probably 100% pick rate.
Mm-hmm. And they're trying. Unless you're going up against, like, heavy, heavy health pool enemies.
Yeah, like Asmodan
plus
tanks.
And you feel like you're not going to get, like, killed so quickly.
Okay.
Yeah. I actually really like what this change means. Increasing the cooldown from 40 to 50, and it's a pseudo-base ability, like, he gets it from the beginning of the game, suggests to me that they're more willing to approach having longer cooldowns be a regular part of the game outside of heroics, which in general I think is healthy for the game, because I like promoting opportunity windows where, like, if you force a Shade out of Azul and don't commit too much, that's like a huge boon for your team. And now having 10 more seconds to exploit that window, I think is cool. I like having that dynamic. It makes competitive way more interesting and enjoyable when both teams are kind of fighting this tug of war to, like, try and see who can blow more cooldowns before actually fighting, etc. And in general, moving in this direction is good for the game.
Definitely.
So they also buffed Shackler in turn. I think that's probably the least pick of the talents, giving it a little bit more slow.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Would you ever use that? I mean, I'm just trying to think of, like, a situation where you'd use it, like, even against, like, a Greymane or an Illidan. I don't even see it being very useful to try to be able to. You're not trying to kite someone Azul, right?
I mean, you know, if you're in range to use Shackler, the enemy's in range to mess your day up. So, like, it's just, like, it's kind of counter to itself because you break it for no consequence. Like, Shackler is a taunt. It's hey, like, you got to deal with me. Like, it's not that much damage. Like, pay the toll and then you can leave. It really doesn't have that much effect, like, in teamfights. Yeah. It goes away instantly. Like, I think if Shackler was an activate and they gave it a duration rather than while the bone shield sustains, we could definitely see, like, it going on. Or maybe it applies a 3-second debuff that, like, kind of like, oh crap, we got to take this out. Or, like, when it finally ends, then we're going to have 3 seconds left. And, you know, 30%, 35%, it's just too small. It's just, it's not enough threat.
I think if they, like, when you said it was a taunt, I actually really like that idea. What if they just increased the slow to, like, 80% or something, and then it's like,
you could break it instantly.
If he pops the bone shield and all your cooldowns are down and you can't break it, like, then it's actually a really meaningful thing. Mm-hmm. Like, that's a cool concept for that version of the bone shield. I actually would like that a lot. I just think, like you said, 35%. I mean, 35% is a shit ton when it's a Jaina perma slowing you from range. 35% is not that much when it's a Zul using his 30-second cooldown that you can blow up with, like, two autos and a Q or something. Like, so it's just not that impactful. It still won't be picked, I think.
I wonder what their ideology on it is. Like what are they really thinking? You know, because, like, you've got Shade, you got Backlash. They're so good. No one's picking Shackler. Okay, let's buff Shackler out. Like, such a small amount. Like, okay, like, what is that? Like, where is that even going? I mean, you're like, it's like you're putting a spoiler on a shitty car. Like, it's like,
yeah. Fair enough. Rathma's Blessing got a nerf to the healing and flowing wounds at level 16. The cooldown reduction has been increased from 4 to 5 seconds. I don't even know what flowing wounds is. I'll be honest. What is that talent?
Q, it's cooldown reduction on a target. Yeah.
Okay. So that's good.
Just so you know, Mortal Wounds is a 4-second duration. Before Flowing Wounds is an 8-second cooldown with, the Bone Scythe is an 8-second cooldown. And then Flowing Wounds had the 4-second. So if you hit someone with it and then you get the mortal from level 20, they have 4 seconds. 4 seconds later, you pop it again. This change makes it permanent. And then there's the slow on 13. That's a 4-second duration. We had another 4-second cooldown. There's always going to be a delay. You know, you had small windows of interrupted CC and interrupted reduced healing. It's gone with this. You got permanent CC and you got permanent interrupted healing. Like, that's what that change is. And that's huge. Like,
this makes the Bone Scythe build way better, right? Like, way better.
Mm-hmm. Very cool.
I think it also, it rewards you for keeping on top of it as well. Whereas before, like, that small window, they get away from you. There's nothing you can do. Like, with this, you can hold on to them.
So, you're talking about this with Mortal Wound being a level 20 talent and then a nerf to Bone Spirit level 20, which was relatively common.
That's what this is.
You just see a shift in the meta being where Mortal Wound could very well be a more common thing.
Majority? I don't know. If we're going towards equilibrium, though, of them being closer to equal, definitely.
Okay. I mean, obviously, you know, I think when Zul was first released, a lot of us were terrified that Mortal Wound was going to just shut down supports to a larger scale than it has. But with these talent changes, who knows? Maybe it could become this big threat where it's just like, you don't get to heal, Dunk. Sorry. Sit in your corner, man, and cry.
Don't worry. I'll be casting Divine Storm and Emerald Wind anyway, so no worries.
Nobody heals anymore. Reducing healing doesn't change anything.
You're right.
People are just dying. The team fight ends so quickly. Who cares who gets healed? Like, Mortal Wounds is just a way to stop, like, a medic heal or an ancestral. That's all it was for. Like given how people play right now.
That's true, man. All right. Well, Zul, we'll see how that ends up in the long term. Zagara, who basically just got reworked in a lot of ways. We've seen basically her new build be fleshed out a little bit, and Blizzard's responding to a small portion. Infested Drop being nerfed slightly. There is a talent that now exists that amplifies this damage, so they're nerfing it at base. The Nidus Network, the creep radius has been reduced. This is a sizable nerf, I would say.
Very big.
And
I mean, does it actually impact stuff though? I'm not sure if it actually changes anything.
Is it gonna win you a game? Is it gonna lose you a game? I don't know. I think that, like, you have to leave a fight 1 second earlier than you did before because you got to stay on creep or the creep's not gonna give you too much distance. It's like Nidus Network creep radius reduction. You might as well have just said, like, Zagar damage decreased by 5%, and that's what it is. Yeah. Like, you know, because you can't stick. Can't stick around. You can't go as far. You're losing the opportunity, like, of the distances you had before. Like, that's where it's going to come into play.
All right. I totally agree.
Somebody let Trixler into a balance meeting as Artanis is seeing some buffs. He's actually gone up from 2245 to 2470 HP with more health regen, 5.5 health regen. He is going to be very tanky, especially with all the shields. That is a lot of health regen. Then Warp Sickness has additional slow. And look at the dev comments. Like, this is how you know Trixler was in the meeting. Artanis asked us for some buffs, and we thought he was a pretty chill guy, so we gave them to him.
So you're saying that Trixler cosplayed Artanis to go into a balance meeting and get some buffs worked out?
I could see Trixler, like, strapping rulers to his wrist with rubber bands and walking into the office.
Yeah.
How could they say no?
I mean, couldn't. Obviously, they didn't, so they can't.
Yeah.
There you go. Case closed.
So 10% health and regen increase. That's solid, especially for a bruiser hero. I feel like that's pretty meaningful. I don't think it makes him insane, but he was already seeing a little play. So I expect to see this just makes him a little bit better.
Mm-hmm. I think that the health change, so, like, Artanis, he doesn't get healed to full in the middle of a team fight. Like, he gets healed to half. So when I see a 10% change in health, what I see is a 5% increase to the bottom, because that's where he's sitting the whole time. It's like, cut his health in half. That's his health pool. that first half, that's just the greeting to the fight that you're about to like have. The health regen is just a response. It's like, get more health regen.
Yeah. Every time we see a health change, we also see a health regen change.
It's percent. So I wonder, they want to keep the percent the same.
Yeah. They want to keep the percent the same. It's like kind of weird to constantly see it like that, but it makes sense if you consider they always wanted to take a certain portion of the time. It's also a little more burst insurance, I guess. So it's a little harder to burst Artanis down before he gets those shield procs. Totally fine. I think he's pretty solid now, honestly. The only problem is wave clear, mostly. And if you can solve that problem, he's a good bruiser, I think.
Yeah, I think what it's really going to boil down to is how small the health is. Like, you know, like I said, it's 5%. It's like, how do you kill Artanis? He pops a shield. You get the shield down, then you have this small window to work on him before the next shield comes up. This 5%, you just gave Artanis like another window of a shield to work with. Like, and you know, there have been, we've all seen the videos of the close call Artanis, where he's sitting on the shield at the very end, and he's 1v3ing against like two supports and a tank. Like with this, like those close calls, like you can say they're just not close anymore. Anytime he barely didn't get a shield, he's gonna get that next shield. So I think we're gonna see like just one extra shield at the bottom.
So yeah, it makes total sense.
I'm excited for it. I've always enjoyed watching Artanis play. And, you know, in a realm where he could be a potential bruiser, I don't think he's going to be Sonya level, but in a place where he actually has a spot in the meta, could be really nice as that off tank. You don't see him as a solo tank, though, right? You're talking about him getting this additional shield, but he's still an off tank.
Okay. He wants to be Sonya, but he doesn't do enough damage. I mean, that's what it is.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
Well, that's it for the balance changes. There are then some bug fixes. We talked about the bug fix to Nazeba with the Toes of Fugitiveness basically being nullified. And then collision heroes can no longer be pushed away. So this is basically just the body blocking issues that we're going through that has all been resolved.
Yeah. Good. So happy that's gone. So happy that's gone.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was an accident, because that same patch, you can push minions and camps around. Something I've been doing lately is when I'm on a tank that doesn't have a way to kill sieges, I get on the backside and I push them into the turrets. So, it would take too long for me to clear it, and so I, you know, when I get the keep involved. And I think something about that spilled over into the collision for heroes. So I guess, you know, we thought that was an intention because it came with the ogres, but it looks like it wasn't, and I'm glad it's gone because I did not like that.
Hmm.
Yep.
And then some gray main changes.
Yep. And then a totally irrelevant, never comes up bug fix: Tyrael no longer possible to deal damage, basic abilities while even
quick
in
match
death.
Change.
So, yeah, quick match change, no big deal. Gray main fixes, nobody's gonna care about those. You won't see that weird video anymore of the gray mains being funny, but no big deal.
All right. Well, those are our balance patches this week, friends, for the Heroes Realm. We are now going to transition over to talking about Ariel, the next support, the first support to come out in the Heroes of the Storm in 8 or 9 months. I have actually completely lost track. Dunktrain, how excited are you? He's going to say not at all.
I'm a little excited. I'm a little excited, not going to lie. You know, I'm not wiggling my seat yet, but I'm looking pleasantly forward to her. I'm a little bit concerned about her. That's kind of tampering my excitement, but I am really happy to see another support join the game, just because it was getting stale. That class obviously needed more love, and I'm happy to see another character added, especially one that looks this cool. And, you know, we'll see how it goes. But I'll talk about my concerns about the character once we get a little deeper into actually talking about it.
Alrighty, well, you know, she's a Diablo support. Obviously, she's basically Tyrael's sister, as far as I'm concerned, because I don't know a lot about Diablo lore. We're going to go with that. They've, again, she's one of the more complex supports based on their listing here. Let's run through the abilities. Going straight in with the basic abilities, actually start the trait, Bestow Hope. Basically an allied hero with hope. While they remain near you, damage they deal causes you to gain energy. So she has a resource, she has her own energy, but she relies on people around her to actually help her earn that energy. And then she can have bestow on one ally at a time. 4% of damage dealt to heroes and 8% dealt non-heroes is stored as energy with up to 505 energy. So 505 energy sounds insanely obscure to me and like random.
Who knows? 505, 450.
404.
Yeah, the numbers they picked, you know.
It's also weird. Do we know if she has mana?
I
like,
no.
I have to assume she does.
We don't know.
I don't know.
You're right. We don't know.
Like, I assume she has mana just because, like, it most heroes do. But the way Bestow Hope is written and, like, the whole energy thing, maybe she just doesn't have mana.
There's no way they're giving her, like, two different forms of resource. There's no way they would do that.
Yeah, I agree. So I think she won't have mana.
That's a good point, yeah. You know, mana wouldn't affect her healing. I don't know how much a Ray of Heaven's going to cost, but if there is mana, it's like how much healing could there be, you know, like, or how much mana could that cost? It's relied on another resource. Okay. And, you know, it's based on how much damage your teammates are dealing. So if they're dealing a lot of damage, you're healing a lot, maybe, like, mana could curb that. But that makes sense. Like, where are they going to store that number? Where are you going to see it?
I mean,
I think that's a really good point.
It's got to be a wheel similar.
That is saying no mana. They are saying no mana, so.
Okay. Yeah, it's got to be like a wheel next to her UI or something, or maybe it's literally just her mana bar fills up, and when it's topped off, that's how much healing she's going to have. But essentially, the way she's going to work is Sacred Sweep. She's got a damage ability in front of her. Ray of Heaven, that's basically where she's going to be using that energy. You will use all of your energy stored to heal allied heroes in the area for an amount of energy consumed. I'm a little confused by this, and I think I might have misread it.
Okay.
What do you mean?
So is it like AoE? Does the AoE get bigger, like based on how much energy you have, or is it literally just the healing amount gets bigger?
I thought it was just the amount of healing.
The amount of healing, I think. And then it's on everyone. So her trait plus her heal are basically like you give someone delayed AoE lifesteal that doesn't necessarily hit them. You can put it on someone else. It's kind of like a weird mechanic.
Oh, yeah, this is kind of interesting way to put it.
It is interesting. Yeah. So my concern, and this is what I mentioned when we were talking about hype for the hero, is that having your healer basically be a lifestealer instead makes me really concerned, since in teamfights that are going bad, you just can't do anything unless you already held a ton of energy from before the fight. And like teamfights, you're crushing, your DPS are getting to do full damage output, they're dodging CCs, or the enemy team didn't hit them right, whatever. Like then your team is crushing and you're getting all this extra value. You're generating so much more value from essentially lifestealing, this huge multiplier to your team's life. So I'm kind of concerned that she's going to be like in the team fights that you're winning, you're just going to absolutely dumpster the enemy team because you're lifestealing a huge amount to your team in an AoE. And then in the team fights that are rough or don't start perfectly, she's going to be basically useless. It's my concern. So I think she's going to fit in as a secondary support for that reason.
Yeah.
Interesting.
You know, it says in the ability, consume your stored energy to heal allies heroes in the area. Does that mean we're aiming this? Like,
yeah.
if we're aiming it, then she doesn't have to be in the fray, you know.
It feels like a flame strike.
I don't know what the range is, but yeah, exactly.
It's probably gonna
be instant.
It doesn't mention any video? Delays.
There's a video. They probably just solved this by watching the video.
I don't think they showed in the video. They show some of the abilities. They don't show them all, if I'm not mistaken. But you can kind of see it in this image here.
Yeah.
I mean, this might be the radius. Yeah. This circle around Greymane, which is pretty large. Yeah.
It seems like a win while you're ahead ability, though.
Yeah,
like Dunk was saying.
That's my only concern.
The only way I could see it being like beneficial for you in on the downturn is like, let's say you're up against a dive comp who doesn't deal that much damage, but they deal just enough to kill somebody. You know, they're a cooldown comp, and you know they're coming and they're trying to kill you, but you know that your comp produces more damage than theirs does. So, like, maybe you've got some healing. You pop the healing, you put it on your biggest damage dealer, like with your trait, let them go crazy, and then you can like use that damage to keep everybody alive.
There could certainly be great synergies with this. Just think of like her with the Greymane, right? You know?
Okay. What if you put Bestow Hope on Zul and he casts Poison Nova?
That's exactly what I imagine.
Is that going to just generate fatty charges as they dive your team?
What about the cooldown on Q? What if it's like 5 seconds and you're like, it's full. You cast it, it's full. And you're like, okay. And then it cast again. Okay, all the damage is done because it's been 10 seconds. So then you got to like pick another target. But yeah, I mean, that's where I got the idea. Like, you have this huge AoE on the incoming team. They take a bunch of damage, you heal. They take a little bit more damage, you heal again. So, that's my hope, because then you're introducing another hero that again is saying like, okay, you guys like diving people. You got so many dive comps. We've got so many complaints about dive comps. Here's your answer. Like, go wild. We gave you Medivh. I guess it wasn't good enough. Here's Ariel.
Both of our heroics are anti single target
Exactly.
kill.
Exactly.
Like, you either can pick Crystal Aegis and give someone Ice Block, or you can pick Resurrect and let them die and then revive them. So, like, depending on the kind of enemy pick comp, it's like this hero seems like she's going to totally wreck the Kerrigan's, the like Jaina combo to kill one target, the like fast damage one target style of compositions. I feel like you're going to get crushed by this.
Isn't it?
You can just save the target and then lifesteal from whatever damage dealer they're not paying attention to.
You know, I agree with what you're saying, but, you know, when you talk about, like, the Kerrigan killing one person or the Jaina combos, like, we already have Medivh. Like, why do we need an ultimate on, like, who knows how long? You've got Medivh right over here with a 5 second. It's nearly the same duration. So, like, when I think about the counter engage, like, that's a pretty cool spell, but, like, what is it for?
It is weird, right?
Like, yeah. I mean, understand the Resurrect. I don't understand the Crystal Aegis.
Yeah. I think the Crystal Aegis is, I don't know. Ice Block is not even that powerful of a talent. Like, level 13 talent, like, it's solid, but nobody's, like, insane about it, you know? Uh-huh. So it's kind of odd to have that as a heroic. Unless it's like a super short cooldown or something.
I guess it, like, you can clear CC and you can you can prevent CC, clear some debuffs, I guess. Like, that'd be cool. Prevent a gust, you know? It could be a, like, maybe you want to put an ETC on the point with a Mosh or something, and then he pops on, you guess the gust, hit it, and then like you save the day. So like I could definitely see there being applications. I don't understand why it has to be on the ultimate. We'll see. We'll see. That's what I'm saying about that ult.
Yeah.
To me, a 3 second channel on the Resurrection seems like a long time, though.
That is a really long time.
I have no idea when you're gonna do that. We're gonna see some huge plays, like contesting a point, getting a kill, and then a counter engage to stall out for the Resurrect. That could absolutely be a thing. I just thought of a fantastic application of Resurrect that some people aren't going to like. Tyrael would be an amazing Resurrect target. He would be absolutely incredible. You could die even in death, go take out your enemy team's half their whole team's life, then push forward, Resurrect it back up. Let's do it again. Let's see what happens. So,
and your Tyrael can sink and then go in and die, and you can use the sink coverage to channel the Resurrect.
There you go. Yeah. Holy Arena, 4 seconds, level 20, even better. Yeah.
Nice.
There you go.
Nice.
Perfect. Perfect.
That's value. Yeah.
All right, guys.
I shouldn't have said it. I shouldn't have said it. It's gone. Now I lost all. It's no longer a surprise.
Blizzard just dropped this hot, fat trailer for Ariel. So I'm watching it.
Can the stream hear the audio?
Yeah, they can.
Okay, I can't, so I'm just going to narrate. Oh, no. Tentacles reach up from the ground, catching Thrall. Zagara throws some Banelings. Medivh casually blocks all of them, which he can't do in-game. They can't be targeted by auto-attacks, but let's ignore that for a second. Ariel comes back, rezzes the Medivh. And everyone's just kind of standing around.
Oh,
all right. One shots the Oryx, so she's pretty OP. One shots Cho'Gall, that seems fair. Okay. And this is apparently enough damage to one shot Ultralisks and Diablos. Oh my.
Dude, what if the ice block hurts things around it?
It does. It does.
It does.
I didn't read the ability at all, apparently.
270. I hope that's the level 1 calculation, because
it is. Yeah.
Yeah.
Dank trailer.
You know, I feel like we haven't been doing this discussion justice, because Crystal Aegis Resurrect, Ray of Heaven, like, we're going, like, all she does is heal and bring people back to life. What about these? What about the CC? Like, what about the stun? Like, close quarter maps with the Tamen Strike? Sacred Sweep, like isolations? Like, this could be, like, so much more. Like, what about that? Where are we going to go with that stuff?
Well, I mean, the Containment Strike is sweet. I really like that ability. I think the knockback and stun is great. It's the kind of, like, skill usage thing you totally want to see. It's great to have on a support. Good for all heroes to have that kind of stuff. I like it. Sacred Sweep doesn't do any movement to them, does it, or anything? It's just damage.
I think so.
Damage. It's okay. I mean, everybody seems to have a just damage button in the game. And since it doesn't mention that Sacred Sweep generates energy, I'm going to assume it doesn't, since I don't know otherwise. And I don't even know if you can bestow hope yourself, but maybe you can.
Hmm.
Either way, it's just the placeholder ability.
I thought you were always like how to bestow on yourself. But
do
now
you?
That I don't know. I can't see. I'm trying to find it. But like, what if... Yeah. Like, you have to always be near somebody, like, to benefit from this. It'd be very interesting. That would be a good reason to make it strong.
All of Ariel's damage generates energy. It applies to itself. But that's the kind of thing that should really be written on a hero page.
Yeah.
That's one of those, like, I'm not sure. We'll see.
Yeah, okay. No, she looks cool, though.
That ability looks like it kind of does that. That'd be cool for, like, clearing a minion wave.
Yeah.
I guess. I don't know how much damage it's going to do. You know, give a healer a clear. That's pretty big.
Oh, I wonder what the cooldown will be. Will it be short enough to be used as wave clear, I wonder?
Yeah, that's what I wonder, too. You know what I bet? I bet you're going to see a talent. Targets hit by the center, take more damage. Or maybe minions take more damage from the center hit.
I can see that.
See that, yeah. Actually, that'd be kind of like kind of overkill, because they're already in a line.
Right.
Would they put... This is actually kind of an interesting question. Would they put a creep damage multiplier talent on a support? Like, we have them on warriors, like Johanna and Leoric has creep damage multipliers.
So that she just has lane clear, you're saying?
Well, I'm just asking.
This is a creep damage multiplier, though. It is. It's there. Like forget a talent. Like, if they bring in a talent, I think it's like two. Like, it's twice. Twice over, because this straight line is already what a minion wave is.
Yeah, but what if you could get 9
but
cakes
I don't think
pawn
long
for
to
that
hit,
talent?
Like, all of them.
That's true. You might have to get kind of close as well. It looks pretty close, too.
Malfurion
like,
does have
a dangerous.
Okay. Yeah, cool.
Oh, yeah, Moonbird.
Oh, that's right. Malf does. Malf
Moonbird.
Does.
Yeah, no, I mean, honestly, she's really interesting, though, as like the off support, because she's got a stun. Not many supports have a stun, but their stun's also a knockback, so it's displacement. But it is situational, because you have to hit them into the wall, but then she gets the bonus damage. But she does have a bit of control. She does have AoE and lane clear. She has the snap call support to try to keep someone alive if you're running double support, of course. I could see the Crystal Aegis having a big impact on some heroes. Maybe it's just to get the cooldown up for an Artanis or something, right? You want to get his shields off cooldown, and Crystal Aegis will have a big impact on Artanis going deep, right? Maybe this cool synergy that exists there. Somebody in chat mentioned just the resurrect on Cho'Gall, right? Cho'Gall's not necessarily in the meta, but that is two targets you're resurrecting, which could be really big in the event that could work out. We don't really know what her tuning is going to feel like in her grand scheme of things, but I see her being a really cool support, because I mean, as much as when I first saw her and I saw Crystal Aegis and I saw Resurrect, I'm like, oh great, a new divine shield and a new divine palm, like this is but they actually seem to function quite differently, and they have some other implications and synergies that are going to make her a really cool hero.
Mm-hmm. They're definitely original, not original like in all video games, but definitely original
for Blizzard, for heroes.
You know, like, no one's been able to ice block their teammates yet, and bringing someone back from the dead, like, there's a new one right there. You could wait. Like, you can give it some time. I wonder how long that lingers. Is it the entire death timer? Because if you get picked on an escape, and you get picked right as you get to safety, like, resurrect, come right back, enemy team just lost cooldowns, and
It also doesn't mention the range, which could be a really big factor.
Sure.
Like, definitely. If the resurrection...
The channel seems like it'd have to be pretty close.
Yeah, I would expect it to be close. But if it was, like, map-wide, what if you could, like, if someone got stitches hooked, you could res them even if they died. And, like, if they respawn next to you, that'd be cool. Or if you could do it global... Like, that would be interesting. Your team's skirmishing somewhere else on the map, and you, like, res someone to turn. Yeah, like, if it was global, that would be interesting. But I think it's just going to be super close range.
Well, the way I perceive Resurrect is being almost like medic's heal, right? She has to, like, channel it 3 seconds, like almost like mm-hmm. the medic heal range. That's how I perceive it myself. But if it's, like, a long range, like, if she can res over walls, like, through line of sight, like, all these different things, like, that's a big deal for her. Sure.
I don't think she's going to be able to. I don't think she's going to have long res range. I was just kind of postulating as, like, it might be interesting.
She got wings. She could float up there, like, be like, oh, yo, who needs that res? Who needs that res?
What, there was a speculation thread about what the talents are going to be. What do you guys think the 20 talents are going to be? Like, what do you think they could be for these new ultimates?
That's a good question.
Like, what I could see Resurrect being another comeback to full life.
All right. AoE Resurrect, level 20. Let's go, boys. And if
Why not
AoE, then maybe just two targets.
Who's going to complain? You killed people. You could just move up.
I feel like the Storm Talent should be that powerful. Like, that would be cool.
Yeah.
For the Crystal Aegis, I don't know, man.
CC. Gonna add some CC.
You think the explosion adds a CC?
Or the the explosion CCs, the explosion vulnerables, or the explosion gives them Aegis armor that does something.
It literally turns them into the Hulk.
Or, I don't know, crystal shielding, or maybe it drops the cooldown by a lot. That's like the first thing I'm like, okay, like, Gul'dan can fear people. What does the 20 talent do? It just fears more? Oh, whatever. You're like, cool. Mm-hmm. Good for you. Like, but this one seems kind of cool. Like, what are they? They're even more invulnerable for longer. Like, it deals more damage. Yeah. So it'll be interesting to see what happens.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, who knows? Obviously, I mean, they haven't given a release date, but considering that trailer was just put out, there is a release date, or did I miss that?
No. Okay. So there was an interview that happened like today or something that's posted on Reddit. That mentions PTR next week, release the week after.
Oh, yeah.
Confirmed. And then that's also the thread where people were getting the information, like, she doesn't have mana, she just has Bestow Hope stacks, and, like, her own damage does generate it, etc. So the information we were missing is in that interview, apparently.
Okay. I'll have to check that out after this.
Okay.
Uh-huh.
I'm sorry, I completely forgot. She has mana, she doesn't have mana. What was the speculation?
She has no mana.
She does not have mana, confirmed.
Spicy. I look forward to it.
Juicy,
very juicy.
Yeah, that's cool. That's really good to hear that she's going to be a little bit unique, you know, in terms of the resource. There's so many. You think about, like, just Sonya, you know, having the Fury as a resource. It's cool to have a support with a unique resource that's not going to be mana. And I like that kind of stuff a lot myself. So, it's going to be really interesting to see exactly what her synergies are when you consider that she is a little bit reliant on someone else to be able to have her effectiveness. So she basically becomes a carry support through a DPS carry. So it's a bit odd, but like you guys are saying,
we'll see.
Very win more kind of hero by the sound of it.
Yeah, we'll have to see.
Yeah, cool. All right, well, that concludes our Ariel preview. She will be going on the PTR, as Dunktrain said, this coming week. So look forward to that. That's going to be a lot of fun. Can't wait to get my hands on her because I have been anxious for support for a very long time, and I can't wait for Demonic Ariel and Demonic Tyrael to be on the same team so everyone is completely and utterly confused, just as confused as their base skins together. She has wings.
Man,
what?
Hold on. I got to do the Gul'dan PTR, and then I didn't qualify fast enough to play Gul'dan. And now now Ariel PTR is coming out. I got too much on my plate. And then I can't even practice Ariel. I can't even see what she's up to because I got Burbank coming up. Like, I feel like I've been cheated out of two heroes.
Get wrecked,
nerd.
So
that's what I struggle with. Okay.
Alrighty, guys.
Sports life.
The next
hero
topic. The next topic here on the show is the new dank Arthas statue that basically just got raised in Taiwan. They spent, I think they said, 9 months and 30 plus employees full time crafting this monstrous 4,000 pound Arthas statue in honor of Blizzard's 25 years as an organization. If you haven't seen this video, we're just going to skip through it quickly. It's on the official Heroes of the Storm YouTube account. I think it's just youtube.com/BlizzHeroes, but I highly encourage you guys check it out because it's so cool the work they've done, the passion Blizzard treats a lot of their heroes. And Arthas is probably, you know, actually easily the most famous, notorious character in the entire Blizzard franchises. Well, spoilers, it's really cool, man. And I got to see pictures of, like, you know, it's like in a public park. So I saw a picture of like all these old ladies like doing their workout in the morning, and Arthas is just standing above them. So they're like, those old ladies are like, you know, they seem like his scourge. He's like commanding them to battle, and they're just like doing these yoga squats and stuff. The photo ops that exist here with the statue, absolutely phenomenal.
Yeah, I think, yeah. You know, professional commissions of video game statues coming into the real world, it's, you know, like, it's a new time. You know, we weren't doing this kind of stuff before, like when it came to like esports and just video games in general and stuff like this. Like, it's weird, it's new, and it's awesome, and I think it's great, and it's like super cool. Like, I hope I can go check out one of these one day.
They have them at BlizzCon. Actually, they have a whole bunch of life-size statues in the Blizzard.
It's not in a park. It's not not out in the world.
That's true.
So, yeah.
True that.
It is cool though.
It's cool. made out of bronze, so they're intending it to like live forever.
Yeah.
So just
like
the bronze.
500 years from now, when the apes have taken over the planet, like,
they're gonna think Arthas was some king that like lived and like ruled all of Taiwan.
They'll worship Arthas statue, like
there's gonna be like writings about Arthas that future archaeologists will attempt to uncover, and all the CDs and all the data and all the internet, it's all going to be gone. You won't be able to access that. So you're just going to have like these carvings and these drawings of Arthas. There'll be no context, and people will wonder what it's all about. So I think it's great. I think it's great to troll the future people.
Definitely.
All right, guys. Well, moving on to the esports discussion, and I guess, you know, probably the discussion a lot of people have been anxious to hear. So this past weekend, we had the final qualifier for North America go down to determine the last two teams that will be making their place into the fall regional, the first fall regional for North America, happening at Burbank in just about a week and a half, actually. So that event is coming up very quickly. And long story short, there was a situation in which Astral Authority ended up getting disqualified, and then there was ultimately, this was all due to a bug that exists with Tyrael, some concerns were raised, a call was made that a bug was being exploited by Battery himself, largely why he's here on the show this week, to give his point of view on all of this. And after after the whole disqualification happened and the situation was discussed a bit, basically a bunch of replays were gathered, video clips created by Astral Authority, and those replays were then sent to Blizzard and ESL, proving that the bug was not actually executed in the way, as far as I understand it. I mean, I'll let Battery explain a little bit better. It's not an easy thing to do, without intentionally, essentially, or, you know, unintentionally rather. And they basically proved their innocence, and the disqualification was reverted, effectively securing themselves their spot that they had earned in Burbank. But Battery, you know what? I'm just going to let you take the driver's seat.
You know, I think that there's been a lot of criticism about ESL and Blizzard when it came to this decision. And I think it's like one of the biggest points that I wanted to like put out there about the whole ordeal is that, you know, looking at the games, looking at the public outcry and, you know, what exactly the bug is and what it accomplishes and how it all works, that, you know, someone casting their smite so close to death, it honestly, it looks like an exploit. It makes total sense, and I do not disagree with ESL's original ruling. It makes perfect sense. You know, I'm the guy who they're pointing the finger at. I was very upset when it happened, but, you know, from a purely objective standpoint, I can't blame them. I can't blame them. It looks like it, and their arguments were just, they were too good. They made too much sense. You know, me just saying that, you know, like telling them that I didn't know about it, it wasn't good enough. They weren't going to take that. And but the thing about it was, you know, they've got their DQ system, but they also acknowledge players' abilities to appeal decisions. And so when we, you know, when we gathered the evidence and we gave it to ESL and Blizzard, they took a long time, much longer than the original ruling, to make sure that, you know, their decision was the right one. And I think that seeing a disqualification being overturned is a great example that, you know, the organization can make mistakes and they can fix them. And like, so like, as far as I'm concerned, ESL and Blizzard, you know, they made a mistake, they fixed it, no harm, no foul. It's like, it's the best outcome there could be. As far as the issue goes, so ESL, if I could just tell the whole story.
Go ahead.
ESL made a decision after the 2-8 My Hot Doge game to DQ us. It happened like exactly 3 hours after the end of the match. And I'm not gonna get into like if that was hasty or not. I don't really care. Like it doesn't matter. But they sent us some messages. Their public statement was, we found them exploiting and they've been DQ'd. And that was their statement. What they sent us, like through the private channels and over email, was they gave us their evidence. They was like, okay, here's a screenshot of Towers of Doom when you dove Falstad. Look, he died. Look at all these numbers. With the smites right on the ground, your smites on cooldown, you dealt damage with smite, man. Like, it happened. And here's another one. You dove that ETC, you died by yourself on that boss call on Sky Temple. Look at these numbers. They're right there. Smites on the ground. Like, you exploited it. That's what happened. And, you know, and they wrote that just because you say it's a coincidence doesn't mean that it is. And our reason for saying that you had intent was because this is a hard bug to pull off in the middle of a tournament. It's a difficult bug to pull off. And you did it twice. So how are we going to say that you accidentally did this twice? It just, that was their way of proving intent. And I completely agree with it. It makes perfect sense. It's a difficult bug to pull off. The fact that it happens twice, it's like the chances of it being a coincidence are so huge that they can't ignore like the idea, or like they don't need the idea that like from my perspective it's a horrible tragedy because it's just so unlikely it would happen. But here's the thing. I come home because I went out to celebrate. Pretty ironic. I went out to celebrate, come back, and I'm DQ'd. I come home. Get on TeamSpeak, my whole team's on, and Tomster and Zuna are on there because they're big buds of ours, and I didn't think we did it. And they're going in replays, and like, and Zuna's like, you know, we're gonna make videos of all these deaths. We're gonna send them ESL and be like, look, no, it didn't happen. And I'm like, oh, okay, Zuna, like we'll do that. And I started like making these GIFs, and what happened was, the Towers of Doom game and the Sky Temple game, I go in here. If you want to scroll down to either the Sky Temple or the Towers game, I've got screenshots of them where it's like ETC and Falstad in either one. A little bit further down, any of the other screenshots except for that one. And I noticed these two numbers are coming out. They're like, oh, like ESL said, that's even in death and that's smite. And I'm looking at these numbers and I'm like, all right, how much is smite supposed to do? How much is reciprocate supposed to do? Which is where the other damage number is coming from. And, like, why are there only two? Like, if Reciprocate's doing damage, and even in Death is doing damage, why isn't Smite doing damage? And I found out that it was only Reciprocate and even in Death dealing damage. There was no Smite damage going on at the time. The two numbers were just, and the fact that Smite was on the ground just looked incriminating enough. So what we did was we made GIFs of every single Death. That's the album I posted. It's got them all. I released it to the public to let people decide for themselves. They pretty much decided against me, but I can't say I didn't try. So it's all out there. And you look at the numbers, they're not the numbers that Smite deals. So we wrapped it up. We made this really nice email, made it really formal. We said, you know, like, we think we've been wrongly accused. If you look at these numbers, you look at these screenshots, made it really nice and clear. You'll see that Smite right there, Smite at level 16, which I believe that was, deals like 280 damage. There's no 280 damage there. There's a, what is that, a 1288 and a 375. I link a screenshot to reciprocate 375, level 16. And, you know, you scroll down to the very bottom, you see the screenshot for the Towers game. It's the exact same story. So, you know, when I say my original argument to ESL was like, it's just a coincidence. It's just an accident. Like, I didn't mean to. And, you know, they said, well, you did it, so we can't take it as a coincidence. So we sent them the email, and, you know, they sat on that email for a long time. I know they didn't want to have it come close to their rematch. You know, no one wants, like, it's a lot of stuff. They want to be as fast as they can. They want to get these, like, these airline tickets. They want to get Burbank set up as quickly as they can. So, it, you know, they didn't want to cancel it so close. It's just what ended up happening. And they decided to overturn it after a very long time of considering that we had proven that I never dealt damage with Smite, which completely negated the accident, like, argument, because there was no example. And, you know, the fallout of all this, you know, some people want to blame me for using Reciprocate. And recently, Blizzard made a statement that Reciprocate isn't a punishable offense. And this just happened, like, literally, like, 10 minutes before this show even started. Let me, in case anybody...
I've got it right here.
Yeah, you've got it?
Upon the initial inspection, it was deemed that the interaction between Reciprocate and Even in Death wasn't an area that that we were comfortable taking disciplinary action on. After much discussion, we decided that the interaction was not something that we wanted to keep in the game, and as such have fixed the interaction between the two talents in the most recent patch. So this is something that, you know, this is CS Steve, Esports Matt, who is the esports coordinator for Heroes of the Storm at Blizzard Entertainment. That's their official statement.
And I do have just a little bit more to say about the matter. Where was I? The Reciprocate bug coming into play and the Smite coming into play. Oh, yeah. So, like, I released... There's a Reddit post. You can find it in the list of Reddit posts that have 0 points wherever it's gone. Or you can find me on Twitter and then look where it got. Because it wasn't very well received. It's got every single piece of evidence that we sent to ESL. You feel free to review the information. I know some people wanted replays. You could just download the replays off the match pages. Feel free to do your own research. Like, check it all out. You know, make your own decision. I've got all the GIFs there. They have all the every single death. It's got all the numbers. You're only going to find the Reciprocate damage and the Even in Death damage. And, you know, I think the number I've been seeing a lot going around is the five cases where I casted Smite within 1 second of the death happening. You know, like, you guys, I get it. I totally understand it. It really, I can see why someone would think that I had intent, and I completely respect that idea. It's a perfectly reasonable thing to have. I don't think that it can be seated in fact or logic, but I do think you have every right to believe what you want given that information. I mean, if I say I didn't do it and you don't believe me, there's nothing I can do about that. And if you say that five is enough, you know, maybe six was enough, I don't know, like... But it's perfectly fine if you want to see it that way. I think, you know, in the months and years to come with Tyr leaving death, you know, people are going to cast Smite, and we might have a different opinion. You might stay the same. But, I mean, really, like, I've said all I'm going to say about it, and, like, didn't deal damage to Smite, and that's pretty much the end of it.
Dunk, any thoughts on the matter, the way that it was... You know, not in the rulings to begin with, and the DQ, and then the official statements that came to follow.
Yeah, definitely. So, it's definitely unfortunate to have this happen. And so, basically, timeline wise, they're playing on stream. People think Astral is cheating. It looks like they're cheating. If you assume that they know about the bug, and then you basically say to ESL, okay, you have to ban these guys, they're cheating, they're not upholding your rules, etc. That makes total sense, that outcry. The immediate DQ looks a little bit hasty in the light of turning it over, although I do appreciate the opportunity to have an appeals process. I think that's really healthy and important. The fact that Blizzard thereafter clarified the interaction between Even in Death and the talent for the W, I think is one of the biggest thing that gets them off the hook, in my opinion. Like, those two talents have been getting picked together a lot in a lot of competitive games. And I think you don't really want to go back and say, like, oh, are all these games invalid because of that? Like, it's just too much. And
yeah,
you know, ESL told us that Blizzard and ESL told us that the bug has to be a common knowledge, or it has to be so obscene that it's just ridiculous advantage. Like Zagara's Nidus buff. Like if no one had seen that before and you pulled out in tournament game, you'd be DQ'd instantly. Like, who cares if it's a known bug? But like this, if you don't know about it, then like if nobody knows about it, then they don't pass any judgment. And their timeline for it becoming public was like 9 PST the night before. And they told us they weren't going to devalue, or they were not going to go back and look at any of the past qualifiers. So, and from where I sit and from where they sit, you know, me saying stuff like, oh, you're going to DQ me? You need to DQ all these other people? It doesn't help me. Like, that just makes me sound more guilty, you know, like it's a hard thing to say. You know, you don't want to be picked out of the crowd, but you don't want to give people fuel, you know, against you at the same time. If you were to go and look at some of the other games at ESL qualifier number 3, I'm sure you'll find plenty of uses of reciprocate even in death.
In Europe and Korea as well.
And it's all the over the place.
I think the best result would have been to let that match play and then make you guys play again against the winner of that match. I think that's what the best total resolution would have been, in my opinion, and just like either do it after the fix to Tyrael or just ban Tyrael, because it is really shady, and I feel like I could have gone either way for sure. If Smite had done damage even once, I would have said absolutely ban it, but having been a player and understanding like you're a Tyrael ghost, I can totally imagine just spamming your W and E, because they don't cost you anything and they can't possibly hurt your team. Like,
this is literally,
you can't possibly know that, like, putting the Smite on the ground, okay, it looks bad. Oh, he cast Smite, Ronu is gonna, but like, why wouldn't you cast Smite, right? You have to look at it from that perspective too, because if I'm a Tyrael ghost in a competitive game, I want to do everything I can possibly do to get value. And like, assuming I don't know about the e-bug, I'm still going to cast Smite, because maybe the way the team fight flows, my team ends up walking over it and gets value.
Right.
Same with W. Like, I'm just going to cast it because I don't want to have abilities not on cooldown. Like, there's no reason not to cast it. It costs me nothing. There's no resource cost.
So, I mean,
like,
I'm also the kind of gamer that
not casting.
I mash my keyboard. I mash my keyboard when I'm dead too. It's like, shit, I just messed up. I just died.
Yeah,
whatever.
Who hasn't casted a zero damage smite on a target that would have been killed by it and just thought, I would have gotten them? Right there, just, oh, I'm going to smite you. Like, it doesn't do anything. It's like, you know, it's like, it's kind of like a B-step. It's just, smite, whatever.
It's still just kind of like it's just a shitty situation, though, because, like you said, it makes perfect sense to be casting the smite in that scenario. Why not, right? There's no reason to not cast it. But, you know, with the bug in place and, like, you know, and then obviously no formal ban set in stone.
This is literally the hot topic. This is where everyone's divided, like, they've got so many arguments on so many different sides. Yeah.
Does casting the smites near the end of the timeline indicate intent to maliciously influence the game? And abuse a bug? It's hard, man. It's really
hard.
If
you like reading, just go on Reddit, find one of those threads, and you will find plenty of opinions about go on both sides about, you know, whether or not that should be incriminating. I think the reason we're talking about it so much is because the playstyle that you need to exploit this bug and the playstyle that's completely normal, they're just so similar that it's so hard to tell what intent is. So you need very objective, non-arbitrary, non-ambiguous ways to determine intent when it comes to these. Like, it's just such a gray area. Like, it could not be more gray. Like, when it comes to this.
Yeah. It's not like the Shadow Assault bug where we saw where he went across the map. Like,
I'm still upset about that. I can't believe nothing happened out of that. I cannot believe nothing bad came out of that.
My final verdict after everything I've seen, I could have seen them upholding the ban or not, and it doesn't. I mean, I'm not sure, man. I think it's tough. Some people in chat were saying that you made some conflicting statements about whether you knew about the W damage specifically before. Do you have anything to say about that? I mean, did you know that the W reciprocate did damage in ghost form?
You know,
before the tournament.
You know, I'm gonna start talking about it, and I'm sure you know chat's gonna go wild when Tyrael. Well, the Tyrael changes first started. Even in death, got changed from 7 to 1. This bug, which Smite could be casted late, it's probably been around forever since Tyrael came out. Like, it's only now that people take even in death, like on such a wide scale, that we've actually discovered there's an issue with it. And to me, reciprocate is just such a staple spell on 7 that, like, I can't not take it. And the thing about how much damage it was doing, and like me, like not trying to figure out why, is because Archangel's Wrath got a buff. It got a really big buff. We're talking like a 2-digit buff. And then on top of that, you've got Even in Death, which is becoming a staple talent with a 25% buff. We're talking, this is multiplicative. It's just getting bigger and bigger. So when I'm playing in a scrim, because this is where like we get most of our ideas, you know, from playing from other people, and I get blown up on by a Tyrael who takes out like 60% of my life, and I know that it recently got buffed, what I'm thinking isn't there's a glitch. What I'm thinking is Blizzard messed up. This is just too much damage. Like, I can't believe they allowed like all these multipliers in play. And like reciprocate, I think it just got caught up, and I just didn't care to find out. I just assumed it was going to get nerfed, and I didn't know until that chat started going off. And like, it was either like one of the, or either a coach or a manager came into chat like after that game was over and said that we were going to get rule booked, and the chat's going crazy. But I didn't know about it until then. I think it was either at that point or when I started doing the research, because it was the smite was the discussion actually that we had. They said it was some smite bug, and it was either at that point or a little while later, very shortly after, that I found out about reciprocate when it comes to the timeline.
So after the tournament, you learned both about reciprocate and the potential for the smite abuse.
It was after the Sky Temple game against 2-8, like just because.
So that wasn't the last game of the series.
That was the last time I played Tyrael.
Okay. Yeah.
That was the last time I played Tyrael.
Well,
if we got DQ'd for reciprocate doing damage, I wouldn't have a leg to stand on. Like, I there's no way I couldn't prove intent or not intent. I mean, I could say I didn't, but the amount of times that
again,
shield does damage.
You were not the only one. There were tons of people.
That's the thing.
Tons of people doing that as well.
The only argument I could come up with is like, well, look at all these other guys. You're gonna like, I'm not saying that we all know. I'm saying that this is a common play style, and we're all doing it by accident.
Yeah.
It's so common.
Yeah. Well, it is what it is. I mean, obviously they've resolved that and put out their official statements in the regard. It's tough. I mean, when it comes to these things, like these kind of bugs that exist in tournaments, you never know when you're going to find out. Sometimes it's mid-event, sometimes it's right before an event. I remember MGA last year at PAX Prime, literally as we were setting up on the event, the players were warming up. I believe it was MVP Black that were warming up. And I remember trying to explain to them that there had just been a bug discovered with Wailing Arrow on Sylvanas. There was a way to reset its cooldown. So you can just have... You could just spam Wailing Arrow. I think it put it on a 10-second cooldown or something.
Okay, so this is actually really funny that you mentioned this, Jake, because we were there and we... Okay, so it's right before the tournament. Apparently this bug is discovered that,
like,
they're demonstrating it.
Literally teams are practicing on stage.
You can partially interrupt the Wailing Arrow cast, so it still fires, but it goes on 10-second cooldown.
Yeah.
And it was a bug which could be performed accidentally without intent. You could accidentally interrupt your Sylvanas cast and get the cooldown reduction, right? So, given all of that, they ban Sylvanas from the event, and they, like, the way it was held, we were literally, like, just hanging around the practice area or something. We weren't there when they were demonstrating to the admins the bug, and, like, an admin just kind of, like, walked by and is like, Sylvanas is banned for the event or something. And like, I actually thought it was a joke because they didn't explain there was a bug. And it was just after, like, the night before we had ranted about banning Anubrak and Asmodan right before the BlizzCon exhibition tournament. We've been talking about that. So, like, I honestly thought it was, like, a joke. And, like, that's a really frustrating situation, too, where you discover this bug and it could have happened accidentally, so they do need to ban Sylvanas. But, like, doing that kind of stuff right before a tournament is rough. And
but that was like, that could be like a tournament breaking thing. At least we caught it. Yeah. We were able to say like, look, no Wailing Arrow. And like at the time, like, you know, it's not like she had possession. It's you're not going to pick up. I don't even know what that's called anymore. Just mega promote, whatever it's called. Rip me. But Sylvanas was very, very common in that meta too, especially for North American teams. So,
you know, like, you guys bringing up, like, this past event, like, you guys talk about this bug, like, before the game even started. This isn't a retroactive thing. Like what we went through on Sunday, you've got this huge population of people that know about the bug. You've got players who are in the tournament saying that they knew about the bug, and then they're implying we knew about the bug. It's like, here, Zuna said it best. If I knew my opponent was cheating, why would I let the game go on? Like, why would it keep going? Like, what is this? You know, like, and I think that it really comes down to like how ESL rulings are. It's like there's a reason they say known bug. It's to avoid situations just like these. And I think that everyone involved like has a bit of responsibility. If you know something, you have to bring it up. You cannot go after the fact and start pointing fingers like as kind of a fail safe for failure. Like,
yeah.
I'm not saying those guys had a plan to lose and then DQ us. Like, but it definitely becomes one once you've lost. So, like, what is there's
dude,
no harm.
I don't think you should even bring that up. Like, that not, sounds.
I don't mean to imply it. I do not. You know, you're absolutely right. It's completely unfair. Like,
yeah.
Like, it's an absolutely unfair comment to make. I'm basically implying that, like, the same thing that people are implying of me. But
yeah.
Like, if you know, you got to bring it up. You got to stop these matches, and we got to get it solved, like, before, you know, like, anything goes bad. Because, you know, a lot of it's, like, the whole known bug thing, it's like that whole honor system stuff. Like, you know, everyone's, like, you just got to be a part of it. Like, people say ESL failed, like, that they didn't know about it, or they didn't, like, put it up. Like, so, like, well, you know, you knew. Let ESL know. Like, you see the rules. You don't see it's there. Like, let ESL know. Get it through. Like, let's make sure no one's, like, getting in trouble here.
Well.
It's Dunkey interrupted me. It's such a touchy subject.
Yeah. All right, boys.
I gotta think about everything I say. It's so ridiculous. Like,
it is. No, it's super close. Rough. It's, when you're under the microscope like that, yeah.
We're driving this panda boat. Over to the Panda Global announcement, ladies and gentlemen, as Panda Global has announced basically their own league. And you know what? I'm really curious to hear how you guys feel about this, because obviously it's nothing but a good thing, but we've had so many similar things like this exist in the community. This is the first time it's an actual notable organization that's had a presence in the community to begin with. But I mean, you think about things like Cheer League, which is still running and doing great as the amateur side of things. And I always expected Cheer League to try to break in and somehow find their way to do something with the pro scene, but they haven't really necessarily done that to a successful extent. I don't know if they've even tried personally. But how do you guys feel about the PPL? I love saying the PPL.
I agree with you. It's totally good for the scene. I'd be really happy if it succeeded, and I don't know that it will, but good on them for trying it.
Yeah, definitely what Dunk said, you know, it's like, it's don't wait for the perfect system to come out. You know, we had, what was it, SEL, Salty Eagle Lords, and now we have PPL, whatever that's going to turn into. You know, like before, like, I think the issue was with SEL was that, you know, it's like, they had the vouching system. It's like, man, who's good enough, like, how do we know? Like, we don't want to waste anybody's time. We do this PPL. We let the top 500 and we let the pros in. You've got a great filter system. And, like, I think it's perfectly fine to let, like, these 500 and what's that going to be, like, 500 and a few, whatever, whoever pros don't.
Probably 550, let's say.
Well, I'm not, so it's at least 501. So, yeah, I think it's fantastic. Like, and I hope that the system works as well as everybody wants it to. And I think it's a great step. I feel bad for Hero League, though, because Hero League wants to be that. And, you know, when these private ladders come out, you know, it's like you're challenging Blizzard. You know, SEL was a challenge to Blizzard. Like, hey, you know what? I don't want this to be like a permanent thing. You know, I want it to last. You know, I want something I make to work. But like, this is like, you know what? This is a criticism towards mm-hmm. Hero League.
Some of the most successful esports out there have had private leagues like this for the pro scene that have helped that become more real, right? I mean, I can't think of an exact example offhand, but I know there's several examples that do exist. Like CSGO probably has similar leagues like this. I don't know if the circuit was Star Ladder actually a full-on just online ladder essentially that was separate from the normal ranking that was designed for basically the esports players. I don't know if you guys know.
I'm not familiar with CSGO, but yeah. I mean, even if you look back at like
you're talking about.
Oh, yeah, IXDL, ESEA. Is that Brood War?
Pardon me, were you talking about ESEA?
Oh, ESEA is definitely one of them.
Oh, I'm sorry. That was a public-private ladder.
IXDL.net is basically a software. It's a piece of software that is used for multiple games, and that was used for Heroes already.
Interesting.
But yeah,
There's that Dota, the very successful in-house Dota private ladder. It's the same software that the SEL did.
Yeah, so it's definitely a cool idea for sure to have something like this. And as you're saying, it's definitely kind of a jab at Hero League saying, look, this is not enough. The pros aren't content with this, trying to promote this. But like, it's not the first attempt at this either. Maybe it'll be the most consistent, most refined, actually have the longevity, but all the other attempts like this for the pro scene have been like enormously popular for like 2 weeks and then everyone stops doing it. I don't know how to fix that. I don't know if there has to be like some kind of real reward or like a great way to be able to brag about it or what. And I don't know what Hero League needs to change in order to correct this to the point where everybody feels the need to create their own fix, essentially, for the ladder.
Actually, two things, probably. One, casters can actually join these games and observe them, cast them, all that sort of stuff.
That's good.
I think that's a huge boon to the scene. So that's a big plus. Also, these systems have the upside of, I don't know whether it's going to be an assigned team system or like a captain's drafting players thing, but in general, I think those systems have inherent advantages where you have a limited subset of people and people know each other. You're more likely to get fun, engaging games where you have the correct balance of people who play the correct roles, etc. in this situation than in Hero League. I mean, that's just a natural fact of how matchmaking works compared to like a more customized system like this.
Something I'd like to see, and not with Hero League. Hero League can be whatever it wants to be, but I'd like to see a private league where you could select a role and then queue in with that role. I think matches like that would be fantastic, assuming you know there's enough of every role or you know how it works, because the game is so role oriented. My opinion. You know, you brought up SEL and like the small community. Like, you try and get 20 people on, but like only like one tank came on, only one support came on, only one melee assassin came on, or two. And then you've got like, you got a team captain who's a melee assassin. He takes a melee assassin. And it's like, like, great. Like, this game should be fun. Yeah. It's just a cherry pick of roles. I like the PPL, like the idea. They said in their statement, it was like, they want to close that seemingly unreachable ledge of the people in the top 100, people in the top 500, and the pros. Like, let's find a way to mingle. Like, let's mix people together. You know, everybody's always looking for new blood. You know, everyone wants to prove themselves, and I think it's a fantastic, like, opportunity for a lot of people.
Well, you know, excited for it. Big shout out to Panda Global. You know, just trying to do something cool for the scene that very well could end up being a mainstay, and I hope it certainly does. But boys, we are actually out of time. It's time for those shout outs.
Oh, darn.
So we get to talk about the patch. We get to talk about Ariel. We get to talk about the dank Arthas statue and then all of the drama. We do in fact have our 8 teams for Burbank, but we'll be doing, in next week's show, we'll be aiming to do an actual preview of the Burbank event, as that will be the following weekend. So I'll keep you guys up to date as to what will be going on for next week, but Battery, take it away, man.
What, shout-outs?
Oh, yeah.
I like to give a shout out to Zuna for giving all the ideas to go and replace Gather the Evidence, and my teammates for not going crazy on Twitter during the whole process. Really helped us out. And I could thank too many people. I've never thanked anybody before, but I'd like to give a thank out to all the lovely people on Twitter who send me private messages. I thought my life was pretty normal, but now I feel really, it's just been fantastic, and I really appreciate it, and I hope to get more of all these lovely, colorful messages.
Okay. Dunkus.
You're basically not a community figure until you start getting death threats, so there you go.
I can't say that you can join the club.
Oh, you haven't?
I thought I was there. Sorry. I'm waiting for it.
If I had known you hadn't gotten death threats yet, I don't know if I would have bothered letting you on the show. Like, you're just maybe not cool enough. Anyway, just kidding, guys.
That's actually my philosophy. You're not famous until you get a death threat. That's absolutely my philosophy, yeah. So, almost. I'm close.
All right, so for my own shout-outs, basically just going to start streaming. There's some stuff I'd like to announce, but it got pushed back, so we'll wait on that. And got some stuff coming in the pipeline, so catch you guys tomorrow on the stream, and see you around.
Awesome. Well, for me, guys, pretty standard stuff. Big shout-out to Asus for the continued support here of the show. And, of course, I also have some announcements coming, but what I can announce is tomorrow I'm going to be working with Beyond the Summit for the very first time, an organization that I've followed for years and years and years. They've done a lot of great work with Dota 2 and Melee, but they've just entered Overwatch. So I'll be casting with T-Squared, a former Halo legend, and I actually used to be a Melee guy, and Halo was kind of side-by-side, so I've crossed paths with him many times, but never really even had a conversation with the guy. So it's going to be a lot of fun to cast with T-Square tomorrow. It'll be casting with Hexagrams, one of the more notable analysts in the Overwatch scene, on Friday. So really excited for that opportunity. And then we got some Heroes announcements coming up soon. I've actually just about completed the project that I'm going to be doing here. I'm going to be crowdfunding a North America Heroes tournament. We did a crowdfund for the Town Hall Invitational a while back. And, there's not a lot of grassroots scenes that events that are geared towards pro teams in North America. And I'm trying to bring at least one or two more a year back into NA. And I've pretty much got it already. It's just a matter of finding the right weekend, finding the right time frame with all the Overwatch and Heroes stuff. And once I do have that confirmed, I'm actually looking to announce it within the next 2 weeks, ideally. So I know I've been talking about that for a very long time, and, you know, the announcements are real at times, but life is chaotic. But I guess that's it for me. And that's it for Town Hall Heroes episode over 115. It was great to hear your thoughts and your point of view and everything, Battery. Actually, you had very, very concise and clean thoughts here on this episode, especially when we talk about the patch notes. Thoroughly enjoyed it, man. And, well, I guess we'll talk to you all later. GG's, everyone. Have a good night.
Welcome here to Town Hall Heroes.